Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Where Are They Now? It's on Discover TV, as you know, and this is our first show of 2021. We know it's going to be a better year. It has to be. It can't be worse than last year, that's for sure. And I'm thrilled to be back and have a very special guest tonight. I'm going to introduce her shortly. You know what the show is about. It's basically me talking to people from our past, local, international South African artists. We talk about their journey. We talk about how they've contributed. And the clock's going wild. So we love that them to tell us their stories, whether they've moved on, whether they're still in their music industry. Where are they now? And that's what this show is all about. Tonight's guest is probably one of South Africa's best known and most loved artists. She's had a career spanning quite a few decades already and is still letting her light shine on the world, the very lovely Sonja Herholdt. Welcome to the show, sweetheart.
Thank you, Cindy, and what a pleasure and what a privilege to be on your show.
Well, thank you. It works both ways, I promise you. I've been so excited about this. We started our careers sort of at the same time, so we are in sync where we are probably in our lives right now. I want to start saying, Die Meisie van Nigel. Okay, that's where it all started. But I think you are definitely so much more than just that. Let's hear your story and let's start at the beginning. Where did music grab you? I know that your mother was a piano teacher, is that correct?
Yes, she was a piano teacher. And I can remember she always told me that when I was still very little, I'd get into bed with her in the morning and say to her, let's sing. So, you know, I think music, and I remember a big black piano in our home, and I used to try and get on the chair, really drag myself onto the big black chair so that I can sit in front of this big black piano and tuckle on the piano, you know.
Of course. Yeah.
So that's what I can remember, and I can remember my first song was Slap My Kanky.
Okay.
That she played the piano, and I had a ballet tutu dress on, and I was 3 years old, and I sang, Slap my kanky, slap sach, onder roosies vanach. And I had a mic, and I remember that mic.
Oh my
and I was not scared at all, and I just loved it.
it was in your bones, you know.
Yeah. Yes.
I always say that music chose me, and I think music chose you as well.
And they say it's a very jealous lover.
It is a jealous lover. I call it my demon lover. You know, it's like, and everything. It's a crazy story. So, from singing, Slap me kanki, slap
slap.
From singing that,
yes.
How did it evolve? I know you were very academic at school. You were an achiever when it came to school stuff.
Well, I studied really very hard, and I think I tried to prove something. Tried to prove, because my parents were divorced. And I think in the light of that, I tried to sort of achieve and show that I need to be seen and I need to be accepted. And I needed to please people, to be seen, to be heard, to be accepted. And that's where it all started. And I just, first of all, I rebelled I actually hated school. I didn't want school until the teacher really took me out right in front of the class and said, you lazy, you're never going to make it. And you are just an absolute twit. And I thought, well, I'll show you. And the next year, I decided to stand first in standard 3, and I did.
Wow.
So, And wow. Standard three. Yes, and yeah. Then I just started pleasing people to be accepted, and I was prefect and high school, in primary school, and I was head girl, and I was prefect in high school, and I think I loved playing in all the school operettas and the school plays in high school, and even in primary school, and that was almost like an escape for me to, to be someone, you know, someone to be reckoned with. And I think that's, if I think of my high school career, then I think of the operettas. And yes, I did definitely study hard, but I wasn't such an academic person. I think I just tried to impress. So I did get an extinction in history.
Well, that's very impressive.
But you know why? Because my history teacher, he did all the school operators at school. I wanted to impress him.
There you go. It's a funny thing that you say about the people pleasing thing, because
yeah.
I think a lot of us, especially in the music industry, you know, we've all had that, like, you know, we turn it on and we want to be loved and liked, and we don't want to be horrible. And that's why hopefully most of us have a manager to do all the bad stuff, you know. The manager can shout at people and do that. I don't want to be that person, you know.
Yeah, but I think that the impressing caught up with me in life, because you can't keep on doing that. You've got to find who you are.
Absolutely.
Because that really catches up with you.
Well, that's our journey, you know.
Yes, that was my journey. Because you try to find your self-esteem in other people's acceptance and in other people's love. And that's not where it lies. And I really had to come to terms with that in my life. Really late in my life, actually. And it's not good, you know, but I mean, that's the lessons, and that's what I can share with people. You know, where do you find yourself worth? Do you find it in all the stuff you do and you achieve, or do you find it deep inside yourself?
Well, I think we know the answer to that, don't we?
Yeah.
And especially, as I say, you said it, you know, it's a journey, and we have to get there. And people say, oh, I wish I knew at 20 what I know now. But you can't, because you have to learn it. And all those things you think you made mistakes, you had to learn.
Yeah, it's like falling and standing up and getting on with it again.
Very much so. And I'd love to show this first video. I chose this one because it's you and your son. And I think that's a very poignant kind of thing when a parent is, their son or their children follow in their footsteps somehow.
Well, what makes Simeon so amazing is that he really didn't try to become Sonja Herholdt's son. He really made it on his own, And the amazing thing about Simeon is he's really a songwriter. I'm not.
Okay.
You know, and I think to my detrimental, I'm not a songwriter. That's you, because you've always got to rely on other people giving you stuff. I give a voice to other people's songs if they allow me to do that, if there's a collaboration between us. Yes. But Simeon writes his own stuff, and he writes the most beautiful stuff. He's really got a gift. So it was wonderful to do the song with him. It's not his favorite song.
Okay, it's not his favorite song.
No, he just did it for me.
I love it, though. I think it's a beautiful song, and I think it's very impressive. As you said, some people sing, some people write and sing, some people just write or just sing.
Yes.
You know, it's what we do. So. I'd love to see that video.
I think I'm an interpreter of songs. I think that's where my strong point lies. I can give life to a song, and I can feel if it works. and I can really get to the heart of the song and to the heart of the people, because that's what I'd like to do. And this song, this video, really gets to mom's hearts or parents' hearts.
Okay. Let's watch that. Julian, okay. I hope you're not eating a sandwich right now, because we want to see that first video.
Swallow quickly.
Swallow quickly. Okay. Not getting it. All right. He's obviously swallowing quickly. So then I'm just going to move on then.
Okay.
Oh, there it is. Oh, yeah.
Oh, there it is. He did swallow.
Ja, ek dink dit pas by die idee van ons vlieg saam.
Okay, kom ons doen dit.
Waar ek al was, moet jy nog weer. Wat ek vergeet, moet jy nog leer. Wat ek al sien, sal jy nog sien, en ek en jy is buitendien, soos die vlerke van 'n arend.
In ma se spore klop my hart, al maak die lewe ook nie sin. Die nag van angs het ek gewen, omdat ma my so goed ken, en ons saam weer kan besin. Ons vlieg saam, saam, saam weer in die reis wat ons self moet vind. Dis die levensreis van de honderdduisend vrae wat ons harte saam bind. Saam, saam, saam weer in die wereld te veer, deur genade.
Where's the time gone?
And where's the time when you see him as a baby? I mean, really? Hey?
Oh.
you know. Yeah,
and they'll always stay small for you, you know. It's ridiculous.
Well, a mother's a mother forever, you know what I'm saying? They're like, so what was it like being a woman in the music industry, you know, in the 70s? Mm. Who is that you were singing with?
That's my son, Simeon.
Also?
It's wow. Also him. Yeah, there he
okay.
is.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's, we did a few shows together.
Okay.
Yeah, there was, yeah, that's right. It's special to do something. And, you know, there's something about your voices that blend.
Yes.
You know, yes. When you sing with your family or you sing with your son. And
people that it just works with.
Yeah. And another, I did an online show with Theo Klassen recently, Familiar Favorites. His voice is also so beautiful, and we really blended together. But I think it's when your spirit blends. Then your voice blends.
Yes. But that's exactly what it is. You either connect with someone singing with them, or you don't.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, I asked the question, women in the 70s, in the music industry. Mm. It's a very different time.
Totally. Yeah. Totally.
Yeah.
That's 45 years ago. I mean, I've been living off my music since 45 years, but now COVID has given it some kind of a different look.
Definitely.
So I will have to think.
Well, I think we're all kind of thinking, you know, we're trying to think out the box really, and do different things.
Yeah, it's really looking inward and thinking, okay, what else, you know, what else can you do? But we'll get the answers. If you keep looking, you'll get the answers.
Well, I think that's what it's all about. Again, it's about the journey, you know.
Yes, it is about the journey.
Being here, it's some kind of, I always look at everything as a gift. I know that people say to me, don't be ridiculous, COVID is not a gift.
No,
but I
it
think
is.
It was, in a way, just trying to get the universe and trying to get the world to just stop for a minute and just think, what is important to me?
That's true. And be thankful for the little things, eh?
Yeah.
Not take things for granted.
Yeah.
And really looking to people, because people are the most, relationships are the most important things, not stuff. People are. And I think we saw that. We saw how people care for one another. And, I mean, going through this COVID time with no income, well, that is this God's grace, number one.
Yeah.
And people just providing from nowhere.
Helping each other.
It was a miracle. It's really been a miracle this year.
I just wanted to tell you that we've got people watching. We've
yes.
got Marion. Marion lives in Germany. And she's saying, Happy New Year. Stay healthy. And Jenny Horton, she's a friend of mine. She said, hello. My late hubby was crazy about you, Sonja.
That's nice to know.
And my lovely friend Craig James from Nashville, Tennessee is saying, hi, ladies.
Yeah, hi Craig, I hope you're well. Maybe you're in a better place than what we are. Who knows?
I don't know. Nashville's also, when you think about Nashville, I mean, Nashville is the music place.
Yes.
And they took such a hit. I mean, if nobody was working. And Lizanne, thank you, Lizanne, for popping in. We appreciate it. We just love that people do come and say hi. I've got to play this next song because it is your signature tune. Of course, it was your huge hit. How old were you when this was your hit? How old were you?
23.
Okay.
Yeah. 23. And, you know, and when these things happen to you when you're so young, that's very difficult because you've got really, you don't have wisdom. And you really are so what's the Afrikaanse woord, blootgestel. You know, you're so vulnerable.
Vulnerable and naive.
And naive. And it's really, you really need some grounding somewhere. And I think I know what held me. I actually know what held me to my feet to the ground. Yes. But you need that, otherwise you're going to lose it. Because you're like on a roller coaster, especially when it took off for me, I was on a roller coaster.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, here's that famous song.
Lang na jou, na die winde wat sy arms om my val. So verlang ek as die son en die maan en die wind en die wolke oor my gaan. Verlang jy ook na my, daar waar jy nou in die verre lande bly. En verlang jy as die son en die maan en die wind en die wolke oor jou gaan. O, ek verlang na jou, na die winde wat sy arms om my vou. So verlang ek as die son en die maan en die wind en die wolke oor my gaan. Verlang jy ook na my, daar waar jy nou in die verre lande bly. En verlang jy as die son en die maan en die wind en die wolke oor jou gaan.
Like so memorable, you know, when you hear that, you look at yourself and you go, was that me? You know, I've lost
among the cushions.
Yeah. I know. I mean, some of the stuff we had to do was so kitsch, you know, that I used to go, oh my god, I'm so embarrassed, but people loved it and it was special. There were so many awards, lots of awards. Let's talk a little bit about that. The Psalmers, I think they were just starting, eh?
The Springbok Radio Awards. South African Record Industry, that's the Sorry Awards.
That's it.
Yes, and I won 8 Sorry Awards, 7 in a row. And a total of 8 Sorry Awards. That was quite a golden era in my life. That's very special. Yeah. And I met up after Act for Long Now with the songwriter Anton Goosen, And we could collaborate. I could sing the songs. The first song that I recorded of his was Yankee, and then all the hits just flowed out of his pen and out of his fingers.
Anton is like that. I love him. Yeah, I love Anton.
Yeah. And so that was a golden era for both of us.
Yes.
And as I said, you know, you need a songwriter to keep you going if you can't write your own songs, which is not good if you can't keep it going by yourself and if you don't find the next right songwriter. So when he started doing his own thing, writing with his own career, writing for himself, I really actually struggled. That's where the growth started again, you know, and that's where you try to find songs, which I couldn't. But my career did actually come, my golden career came to a halt there. And also, my marriage also took a nosedive.
Yes. Because that song, you were singing that song for somebody special in your life at the time.
Yeah, yes. Actually, Jan de Wit wrote that song, not Anton Huysen. Jan de Wit wrote the song, and my ex-husband, Efsia, at that stage, he was my boyfriend, he co-writed with Jan de Wit.
Really?
Okay. We actually changed the chorus to fit the movie, because I heard the song when I was studying at Gautsta Teachers Training College. And then I sang the song and to FC, and he was working on a film with Gordon Foster. And then we used the film in the movie. Used the song in the movie. And out of the movie, it got onto a single, and when it started playing over the radio, it just got to the people's hearts, and that's where my career started. You know,
so you were studying to be a teacher?
Yes, yes. And I actually taught for a year, and during that first year where I taught as a Standard 3 teacher, young teacher, this song, I recorded the song, and it just, it just happened in that year. And
so
I won the story.
So you were still studying?
Yeah. No, I was teaching.
You were teaching, okay.
I was studying when they did it for the movie, it for the movie. And the next year when I started teaching, we put it on a single. And then it became popular and I won the story. And Jan de Wit got the award for the Song of the Year.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, it was a very special song. For its time,
even though,
you know, it was an Afrikaans song, but I can still appreciate it.
It still lives today.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's why when I hear it again, I was just so taken by it. It was beautiful.
It took you back.
It did, definitely did. You also got a bit of an acting career later. Was that fun?
Yeah. Yes, it was. I actually wanted to take up drama.
Yes.
So, but my mom said to me, rather go for a teacher. You are actually a teacher at heart, which she was right. And there's always something to fall back on. Well, which was a good thing, because when my fourth child, Timothy, turned deaf, I really had to start a school. And because I was a teacher, I could start a little school for the hearing impaired in Afrikaans in Johannesburg.
Yes.
So that helped. But anyway, getting back to, I wanted to study drama, which I actually didn't, but I think I'm a natural actor, I think I am.
Performer, yes.
I played in my first movie, Sing for the Arlequin. My ex-husband shot the movie and it was a success. Because I actually won an award for the best actress, and best newcomer.
Wow.
A report.
That's
Oscar.
Incredible.
Yes.
An Oscar. Funny report.
Report
I
Oscar.
That paper? Nothing
you remember?
Wrong with that. I remember very well.
Yeah. So that was my first movie, and then about 30 years later we did Liefling. Where I had a little role in. the movie as the mom of Liefle.
Was Gai Korsten?
No.
Did he sing that song?
No, well, the movie was Liefling.
Yes.
One of the songs where Gai Korsten sang Liefling was also in the movie.
That's what I remember. He wasn't in the movie though.
No. Okay.
But no. I remember that song very well. That movie, I remember that voice.
That movie, Liefling, was done in 10 years ago in 2010.
Oh my goodness, okay.
Yeah, time flies. So that was the two movies I played in.
But still, I mean, it's there, you know.
Yeah.
Nobody can take any of this away from anybody.
No.
Once it's done, it's done.
Yeah, but I'm proud of it. I'm proud of both.
Of course.
Yeah.
And so you should be. You spoke about Timothy. You said that he I read about it, that he had an illness and he went deaf.
Yeah, that was a big shock. You know, when you're confronted with something, with the unknown, it's fear, you know. And then you've got to confront it and you've got to work through it and you've got to make it work. But he's quite an amazing child.
Sure.
And that was really a growth time in my life.
Yeah.
When he turned deaf. But then then you start seeing the beauty in the brokenness of life. If you're not confronted with that, then you don't see it.
No.
And but he's a special
child.
You
can't grow from that, you know.
No.
And of course he's a special child, and I think that might have sort of stopped your career in a way a little bit.
It made it maybe slower, but I never stopped singing.
Sure.
I used to sing over weekends, and in during the week I used to teach and help Timmy. But it was a very difficult time. It was a time of really looking inward. And it was a time where you've got to come to terms with stuff, you know, stuff that you can't do anything about. You've got to accept it, and you've got to make peace with it, and you've got to never lose hope, because, you know, somebody said hope opens the door to endless possibilities if we only have a little bit of faith, you know. So
that's
I just had to cling. I had to cling to that hope and to the faith. I think the thing that got me through even starting singing in 1975 up until now is my childlike faith. It's just kinderlike geloof, as they say in Afrikaans. You know, that just pulled me through even up until today.
Well, I think, as we said, the word naive, innocent faith, that, you know, people also say to me, how did you get through this hard times in your life? I say, maybe I'm a bit stupid or a bit doff, you know, I just kind of kept believing that it was going to be okay.
Mm.
And I think that that's a very special thing.
Mm.
And the school that you started for hearing impaired, is it still going?
I started I taught there for 5 years, and then it became part of the pre-primary. That it actually really kicked off the pre-primary school to grow even more classes, but because I left there was no really another teacher that could follow in my footsteps. Because when Timothy went into primary school, I thought, well, you know, now it's time for me to concentrate again and make a living, you know.
Sure.
Because after that, I had a car, I was in a car accident.
Yes.
Where I really had to come to terms with the truth in my life and to weigh the consequences and to make a decision to really stop lying to myself, and then I got divorced.
Okay, so that was the thing. That was the catalyst, they call it. You know, when something goes, okay, now I know. It's cleared the path for me. You know, life-changing experiences are there to change our lives. Sometimes
absolutely.
When we don't do it, the universe does it for us. It comes and it gives us a cosmic slap. Wake up, man.
I really needed to have a supernatural intervention so that I could listen to this inner voice and stop pleasing people and listen to this inner voice speaking to me, because that's really the truth. That's your intuitive voice, you know, and that's your voice that you need to find. And then I got up and got divorced, and I was at slap bang in the gospel movement at that time, because after my husband and I tried to get it together, we went to we had a really spiritual deepening, and we went to Rhema. Rhema just started the church in Randburg.
I remember
It meant a lot to me because there was a lot of growth. But then you start actually using a crux to cover up all the flaws that you don't want to make come to terms with.
Sure.
And in that time, I had all my children, but I was actually within this movement, which was not I was not lying to myself within the movement. I really had experience with my relationship with God, and I accepted Jesus. I never grew up out of a traditional home. I had an experience at college with a meeting with Jesus. I've always been I almost don't want to say to you a Christian. I want to say to you that I was really a follower of Jesus.
Okay.
And that changed my life. That also pulled me through, even in the time with my marriage, going to Rhema. But then you can become part of a system that can so easily become a traditional thing that you find comfort in.
Yes.
But you're still lying to yourself.
That's it. I know exactly what you mean.
And deep down you actually know it's not right. This marriage is not working, but you're just making it work because that's what they say you should do. You should pray it right.
Yes.
And then with this supernatural intervention with a motor car crash, I woke up. And it's almost if God said to me, you are more important to me than anything else. And think about you. Think about Sonja. Think about who is she?
Yes.
And I think the fact that I made the decision also helped my ex-husband, although he didn't want to believe it. I don't think, maybe.
I'm sure.
I don't know. Up until now, maybe he still does, but I don't know. But it was a shakening. And the gospel industry just closed their doors to me and said, no,
divorce.
This is not right. This is not what the church wants. So we're closing our doors to you, and you're going to carry negative spirits over if you come and minister to us in church. So I thought, well, fine. Now I'm just going back into where I come from. And you know, as a matter of fact, I'm reading a book from that Rob Bell, his latest book, Everything is Spiritual. Everything is spiritual.
Yes.
There's not spiritual and secular. Everything is spiritual. You know, and I believe that I could just shine my light wherever I go. And wherever, even if I have to sing, and I really, literally, when I started, after I got divorced, I had to sing all over.
Yes.
I had to sing on pavements. I had to sing in restaurants. I had to sing in in Russell's shops for people, for drunk people, just to make a living, to not go under and to look after my four children.
Sure.
So,
but it's, when you're faced with that, you make a choice. You just say, yes, it's do or die. You know, I've got to survive this.
Yes, and I did. I just kept going, and in that time I did try and do some other recordings, but I could never really make it back to the fame of the 70s. But you can't do that, because that was the era. You've got to move on, because nothing stays the same, and you've got to find your voice, and you've got to find, what do I need to do now? And live in the moment and decide, okay, where can I make a difference now? What is the meaning of being here now? And that I had to do for the last 20 years. But it was a lot of growth. When I recorded Reconstructing Alice, that album.
Definitely, because I want to talk about that later.
I had to tell my story.
Yes.
So that was a musical growth. It was an inward growth. It was because you need to tell your story to find healing.
And to find yourself again.
And to find yourself.
Who am I again?
Yes.
I'd like to see some other photos. Let's look at some of the pictures from way back.
Okay.
There's so many great signing autographs. Oh man. That's adorable.
Oof. Yeah.
Wow. I love these pictures. I love. Oh my
I was playing the main role in I was Cinderella in Durban.
Okay.
In 1980. Yes, 1980.
Was it a pantomime?
Pantomime, yeah.
Oh my goodness. That's fabulous, darling.
That was amazing, because it's playing on the stage and you've got to be bigger than yourself, which I didn't know how, yes, but I got it right in the end. And okay, that was in the movie.
Okay.
That was in the movie, wow. Sing Three Idle Kain. That's my ex-husband.
Okay.
And that was some place.
Show.
Oh, that was at the Lurie Awards. They invited me to...
Nice.
To sing at Philong Leona Lurie Awards. Yeah. And I actually thought the people was not going to stay, but they stood and they actually cheered and they actually, I mean, some of them actually sang the song as well.
It's a story.
Yeah. And that was when I got the award at Scospel. What's it? Achieve Award?
Lifetime Achievement
yes. Award, yeah.
That's a big thing. Wow. Yes. That's absolutely fabulous.
That
I
was
love it.
2010? Oh,
and
that's all my gold discs.
Gold discs? Wow.
Yeah.
You know, these are huge achievements.
Oh, that's when I got my report Oscar. That's nice. Buerta.
Nice Buerta.
Yes, he handed me that award that's standing there.
Yes.
Yes.
It's adorable. Well, look at that.
Glenys awesome. Lynn.
Oh my goodness, yes. Isn't,
yeah, she was an amazing lady with four Jacks and a Jill.
Yes, I'm actually going to have them on the show as well. They're lovely,
yes,
lovely.
Yeah, she's a special.
And is that Mim?
Esma Everard
from the radio. Oh my gosh.
Johnny Esma gave me my second Sorry Award in 1977 over there.
Wow.
Yeah.
And look at you playing. Is that
my
piano?
Mom. That's another piano that my mom gave me that's standing in the house here at the moment.
Oh, my
God. Yeah. Oh, and that was the report cycling. Report Fitztour. Yes. I toured with them in 1980.
Okay. And were
and
you singing
the champagne
with them?
I sang at all the ports where they stopped.
Okay. I love it. The things we do. I mean, dear. I went to the border for the, you know, the army guys.
Yes, me too.
Sung for the soldiers.
Yes, me too.
Who is that?
That's Francois Hayes. We did some tours in 1982. That was just before my first lady was born. Oh, and that was recently with Anton Huysen. They did a tribute to him, and I was one of the guests on his show, and I sang with him there. Yes, El Anton.
Well, yeah.
He wrote beautiful songs.
Oh,
yeah.
He's a special guy, you know. He's a special guy. Well, I mean.
Oh, and that's David Kramer.
David.
Yes, I sang his song Skip Skop.
Okay.
He came to me at that place there, and he said to me, Sonja, I just want to thank you for making Skip Skop a hit. So I thought, wow, that's something to say to
Isn't
me.
It? Yeah.
Yeah, that was special.
You know, as I said earlier, nobody can take away anything that we've done or you've done, no matter what you've been through. We talked about life-changing experiences. Coming back from that, after you've been shunned by your community, so as to speak, and you've kind of been, I understand that very well. I've been through that as well, where nobody comes near you. You're like a, don't touch them, they poison, you know what I'm saying? And you have to come back and you have to believe in yourself again. You also started working with women, doing like sort of, what were they? Like sort of talks and things like that.
Let me tell you how that happened.
Yes.
After I told my story with Reconstructing Alice, that album.
Yes.
That was a very controversial album. It was the album really turning inward, and I had to find myself in the album, or on the album. I was cross. I was. Actually, it's an album that's very different to Sonja Herholdt that the people grew up with.
Sure. So you were speaking your truth.
Yes, one of the songs I think was on the. I must actually ask. On the essay Rock.
Digest.
What do I do now? And somebody said that I sounded like Alanis Morissette on the album. And I remember What Do I Do Now and Vertigo. They played it on Highfelt, and Sam was there, and on Radio 5 as well. But they only played it once because that sound doesn't suit Sonja Herholdt, and they can't use the name Sonja Herholdt on that station. Because the name and the image of Sonja Herholdt doesn't suit the sound. So that's why
totally
the album didn't
Never
really
did
work
well.
On the... No,
yeah.
Because you've got this perception that people have of you, and you can't really grow out of that. The people don't allow you to grow out of that.
They don't.
You can't really get past your legacy, you know?
Totally
can't grow, you can't grow out of that. But that album really created sort of a new audience for me. People that said, wow, but she confronted her stuff. I can also confront my stuff. And even the gay community. I've got a large following of gay people, gay fans.
Yes.
Because they had to confront stuff. They have to still confront stuff all the time where people don't accept them and it's not acceptable.
Absolutely.
So many women after this album came and said to me, wow, Sonja, you spoke to me on that album. And then I decided, but I've got a voice. I found my voice. I've got something to say to women. And I can get them to listen to what I have to say, and then I can let them, I can help them to tell their stories as well. And then I recorded a CD, Verhalen van Vrou Wees, where I got people's stories and I just changed the names and I just shared their stories. And this CD really helped a lot of women. Because if we don't, it's narrative therapy. If we don't share and talk and speak and share our stories, we don't find the healing. And if other people listen to it and identify, then they find the healing in your story. So that's how In Celebration started. But then after a while, I decided, I can't really start, I can't start this organization. It's not going to work. You need money for it. And you need to be the right color at that stage in the country.
I understand.
To do that, to start this organization and people that's going to give you money to do that. So I just decided, well, it's going to be a motivational musical experience. And this is why I'm doing music motivation and inspiration. And I just share my stories and I do it in a real smart way, because I've got this amazing husband. He's like really the wind beneath my wings.
Oh my
and
gosh.
he's technically helped me, and we've been together for a long time, but we've been married now since 2017, but I've kept it out of the press because they don't need to know everything, you know.
Sure.
I keep him out of the press just to
it's your just thing. To keep it's it your private. Private thing. Absolutely.
Yes. But we've been together for a long time, and we've worked together, and he is really my other half. And I can't understand why that's what I can't understand about life. One day I want to know, why do I only meet him now? I should have met him ages ago. Because we're soulmates.
No, but sometimes we have to wait for these things. And you had to grow. You had to be the Sonja that you were when you met him. Mm. You couldn't be the Sonja you were before.
No.
You had to be through that. I just wanted to look at some of these lovely messages. Oh, man. Martin Pinar.
Oh,
Martin Pinar.
I know Martin Pinar. He's a very special, very special friend. Yeah. Yes.
Sonja is simply number one, and you will be blessed in 2021. I love it.
Okay, thanks, Martin. I take that.
I have tea. Marion's asking if I have tea tonight. I always have tea.
Yeah, and I'll have a glass sip of water with some lemon in it.
Oh, that's very healthy. And Marui Skuman, hello. Terry Barker, Jeff Abrams.
Oh,
thank
yes.
you, Jeff. Very nice. My neighbor.
Oh.
I like that.
That's
Jeff,
nice to know.
Your neighbor. So, just so you know, people are around. Sonja, how many records have you sold, do you think? How many? Okay, so let's start. How many albums have you released? Do you know?
I think around about, I've lost count, but I think it's around about 35 maybe.
35,
38, around there. The last one was Paddles, and that turned gold.
I want to see that video. We've got a video of Paddles. I want to see
yes,
it.
Yes.
Please. That was gold. Hey, when was that?
Yeah.
When 20, did you release? 2010.
Okay.
Yeah. This is a beautiful, beautiful video. Here we go. Beautiful. I love this.
Ek verlang nie meer nie. Hierdie hart is heel. En die blou dan branders het op laatste lied gespeel. dis die eerste liedjes waar die langste hou. Dis die laatste woorde waar die droom van morgen bou. En nou gaan my woorde aan aan nieuwe lande. Die hoop en drome waar die nag oorwin. Dis die son in elkeen wat van vooraf kan begin. En nou gaan my woorde aan aan nieuwe lande. Hou my hande vas aan parels in die woorde wat my reg opbou. Wat my bring na jou.
Yeah, I think it's got a symbolic story about us as women that grow up with this dream that a prince on a white horse is going to come and save us.
Yeah.
You know, because we're
taught.
Yeah.
From when we were young, you know, Cinderella story.
That's the idea of this video, but actually we should find that hero within ourselves.
Yes.
That hero is not going to save you. Come and save you, you know. You've got to just find it within and find the truth within yourself and find the strength within yourself.
Because only then can you find those that will stand for you.
Yes.
So you found your husband later in life, the true flame, the true twin flame, they call it, you know. And it's real. I mean, you've got to have that journey. I always say that, and I know it sounds a bit boring now, but I totally believe that life is a journey, and it's not about the destination. It's about the journey. It's about learning and getting and eating it up and falling.
Absolutely.
And standing up again, you know.
And you know, we are really only grow through pain. And yeah. I sing a song called Born to Be. Of actually heard the song on Susan Boyle's album, and I really identify with this song. And because we always compare ourselves to other people, and then we feel intimidated. But you've got your journey. I always say the footsteps are ordered by the Lord. And you should find your journey and not compare yourself to anybody else's journey, because you are called for a specific walk in this life. Then you know who you've been born to be. And that's why I sing that song. It's a beautiful song.
Well, I mean, I didn't understand all the words. My Afrikaans is not as good, but I understood a lot of it.
I just want to tell you, I was a great fan of I'll be your substitute. I just want to tell you that.
Thank you. Yeah, I was also a little pop star at one time of my life, you know. Also had to fall hard a lot of times.
Don't we all? We all go sort of the same route, don't we?
Well, I'm glad I did, you know. I'm glad for all of it. And I think it's important to share these stories, and that's why the show is so important to me, because everybody's got a different story, Sonja.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
everybody's got a different thing. I mean,
absolutely.
I know you've got a book out, you've got an autobiography. I also wrote a book. What is your book called?
Macy van Nigel.
You see, I knew that was going to come in eventually.
Because you've got to, you've got to know, you've got to find your roots, you've got to know where you come from to know where you're going.
Absolutely.
And you've really got to find the jewels and the gems of where you come from. You mustn't forget that, and you mustn't lose that, and you must be thankful, and you must give credit where credit is earned, you know. Where credit is due.
And that's also something we learn later in life, because I know how I was brought up was also very similar to grounding, family, you know, being together and stuff like that. And it always kept me on track. Even though I was a rebel as well and I went crazy and did crazy things, there was always something that held me. So when I ask you this question, it comes from that kind of place. What matters to you? Because what matters to us when we're 19 or 20 or 25 or 30 are different things. Right now, right here, where are you now? What matters to you right now in your life?
Just before I answer that question, I just want to quickly backtrack. Going back to where you come from, you know, my mom got divorced, and as a child, you've got to deal with that, and I don't. Those days you don't go through therapy. These days everybody goes through therapy.
Absolutely.
Those days you've just got to figure it out.
Fast bait. Fast bait.
And I actually blamed her for getting divorced.
I'm sure.
Although she had a hard time. She had to get up and get divorced. At a time in her life where that's totally out for to get divorced, you know, as my mom. She was very alone. But when I got divorced, then I understood. And it's funny, but then I actually got to her heart. And that's like 30 years after I was born, you know.
Sure. I also had to realize who my mother was later in life.
And then you understand that you have empathy and you feel, because you can't judge anybody if you don't walk in their shoes. And if you don't go through all these things in life, you don't understand, you don't become the caring person that you actually should be, with wisdom, with love, with empathy,
compassion,
with compassion, with forbearance. And what matters to me now, really, is to be able to use my talents, because I'm not old yet, and I don't think anybody gets really old in the music industry. I don't think so, because age is in your head. you know, and you think yourself old. And I can't find anywhere, anywhere in the Bible where people have to retire. Why do we need to retire? Why don't we just keep on going, doing the best we can do to make a difference where you are, with what you have, with the talents you have, with the energy you have? Because the older you get, the younger you get, because that's what I believe.
Yes. Well, you know, because you handle life so much better and you feel lighter. You know, I feel so light and like whatever, you know.
And I think when you become creative and you create and you change your thinking in your head, and you because if you change your thinking, you change your subconscious mind, and you just know that there's the best is yet to come, and that's where I am. And yes, we will have heartaches and we will have tough times, but tough times never last, but tough people do. And if we fall, we get up, and we never, ever lose hope. Because, as I said, I have this inner belief. I am a follower of Jesus, and I know that He said there's always hope. And with Him, nothing is impossible. And that's where I am.
And that's an amazing place to be. I mean, that's so inspirational. Everybody is writing here. They're just writing beautiful messages.
Sure,
hello, ladies.
Nice.
You rock. Much love to you both. Wishing you all a happy and healthy year. The lady was the highlight of my border trip to Ondangwa.
Oh, dear. That's nice to know. Ondangwa. Yes, I remember.
What a show she put on. Always professional, fabulously talented artist. My friend Jenny loves your dress in Perils. And Fame organization. They're fabulous people. They've got lawyers and people that help people in the music industry that don't know. So hi, thank you. It's so nice to see everybody. Christian Stein, that's who runs Fame. And Graham Smith, Allison. Hi, Allison. Good interview. She wants to know who writes your songs and which record label is your favorite. Well,
I've been with so many record labels, but I'm nowhere. I'm an ID. What is in the independent?
Indie. I'm an indie.
I'm an indie.
I'm proud to be indie, baby.
No. I'm just doing my own thing, and I'm taking responsibility for myself and for my own stuff.
Yeah.
I'm doing a kiddies thing at the moment, Sonja and Choka. So that's all.
Ooh,
we own that.
Nice.
And
okay.
I own Reconstructing Alice. And it's always nice to have a record company because they give you the money, but they own you.
Sure. Yes.
They own you.
It's another story.
That's another story, and it's another story also to say that when you become a celebrity, you become, I don't know how you say that in English, but you become a winkelpop.
A commodity. You know what I mean?
A commodity, like but it's like a mannequin.
A mannequin in a shop, yeah, got it.
Because they own you.
Yeah.
And you must make peace with that. Because
that was
you...
That hard, yeah. You're a puppet.
You're a puppet, and there's the Sonja Herholdt puppet, and people want her to stay the way she should be, and not be
change, don't change,
not change,
yeah.
And not be a person with flesh and blood and feelings, because it's almost you removed from that puppet, you know, and that's very difficult, because you've got to manage both. With lots of wisdom.
With lots of wisdom. And I think also nowadays, Sonja, things have changed a bit. People like, you know, yes, of course, there's all the bling and the blong and the marketing and the big show and the fireworks and everything. But I think, well, people that I've come into contact with, they want real music now. They want somebody with substance to tell them their stories. They want to hear something that touches them, that touches their soul, makes them feel something.
I've never been able to sell my soul for silver. That's why I changed. And that's not very clever, because if you want to make money, you should stay the same. You know what I'm saying?
I know what you mean. Yeah.
Then, if you want to stay commercial, then you can't really share your heart and change.
No.
And then to some sense, you do sell yourself for silver.
Sell out.
I could never do that. And that's why I think you get to people where you maybe get to a smaller audience where people really...
That's what I'm talking about.
...want the substance.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's fine. That's what I want to do. I want to sing to people's hearts. And that's what my son is doing at the moment. He's working on a boat as an engineer in the Pacific somewhere near France. And he said he's just going to make money so that he can come back and just write songs. Write songs for the people that want to listen to what he's got to say. Well, and I think that's the difficult thing. You can't really live off your music in South Africa. I've done it for 45 years, but
I've also
done
it for 45 years, and it's hard. It is hard. And especially now, it's very difficult.
No.
But look at us, girl. Look at us. We are sitting here after 45 years.
They say we rock.
You see, we rock. We do rock. My goodness gracious. This has been so beautiful talking to you. Everybody that's been watching, if anybody wants to watch it again, you go to YouTube and you look for Where Are They Now with Sonja Herholdt or whoever you want to watch. This has been an absolute pleasure to speak to you, to find out the real you, which I love. And I know the people that are watching love that. My last question for you.
Mm-hmm.
You said you're reinventing yourself all the time and everything.
Mm.
Have you let settle in your heart the mark you've made? Has it settled with you? The mark you've made as an artist, as everything that you've done, even the things that you thought were failures?
I've always been very honest. I think that's my strong point. I've always been down to earth. I could never really be a prima donna. I think if I was, maybe you've got more respect from some people. I could never be that. I've got a song, Die mense wat ek lief het. Kom groei op my soos mos, dan laat ek al na hartelis gedei. And I've always opened my heart and my life to people, and I've never been up there where
I know
where you actually should. People want to see you as a star, but I've always been available, and that's also not good enough, because people don't want that. It's this whole thing with this mannequin and this real person. You mustn't be so available. But I've always been so available. So if I think of my life and I think of long time ago, it's almost as if it's been a dream. Has it been real?
Mm-hmm.
Did it happen? Did I go through all of this?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just so thankful. I'm thankful. I think I'm thankful for everything that has happened. And I think, yes, I have come to terms with. I think I've come to terms. I don't think that I've... People say, wow, you're a legend. And then I think, am I?
What is that? Yeah. I know what you mean. I know exactly.
Have I answered your question?
You've answered my question so beautifully. And exactly as I would think that you would answer my question, because I totally understand what you've said. It's been my path as well. you know. Mm. So mm. we've definitely fed off each other, and this is not my interview, it's your interview. But when you say something that resonates with me, I always have to say, hey, it happened to me, I know that, I feel that. And I think you've shared so much of you.
You know, Cindy, if you read my book, you'll understand what I've said now, because I really opened up my heart, and I didn't mention people's names really. But I shared my story, and but I also mentioned all my mistakes, so that I could be vulnerable, because it's so important to be vulnerable, because then you can really get to people's hearts. Yeah. And the important thing, and now it's all out of my head what I wanted to share with you. Now it's gone.
Don't worry.
But I think the thing is that if you no, it's gone. Make an important point. It's gone.
If you're real and if you're honest, then it touches people. They get it. They understand it.
Yeah.
I think that you've said everything perfectly in this beautiful shell.
Yeah, and I think once the interview's over, then I'll know what I wanted to say to you.
And then you're going to tell me, and I'm going to post it, okay?
Well, you know, you understand, because they say it takes one to see one.
To see one, absolutely. Yeah. And there's a lot of people that see what you've been talking about today.
Mm.
Absolutely.
And it's been such a great pleasure.
Has it? I'm so happy.
It's really been a great, great, great pleasure. I love your earrings.
Oh,
I love
thank
your
you,
earrings.
Very big. They're very big.
No, it's beautiful.
Thank you, Sonja. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on the show. I love this medium that we can just sit and talk like this. And this is our studio. I send you many blessings for this year, for everything that you're going to be doing. Thank you. Stay who you are. I want to play out with that other video that we saw earlier. I love that as well. Thank you for everything. And thank you, everybody. And thank you, Julian.
Yes, thanks, Julian, and thanks for having me. And it was a bliss to be on your show. Mwah.
I'm so thrilled. Thank you. Woo! Okay. Let's
Bye.
End up with something fun and dancing. Woo!
Jou. Zoom my nose. Soon as I saw, 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 soon as I saw